Thanks for being with us this Monday night. It's been 3 days and three very difficult days for all of us parents across the country. Ever since 7-year-old Pradyuman's murder took place inside his own school, there is anger, there is anxiety, and there is also immense helplessness as well. How do we break into a system that refuses to follow the law? A school which has been in the past a repeat offender on security lapses. Has the Haryana government or the state police acted well in time? Why are parents still suspicious here that the real culprits in this murder case are still being protected? I'm Seher Zama and we at Mirror Now have made this part of our campaign. Hashtag make our schools safe. Let's throw this open to our panelists tonight. We have Dr. Ejaz Ilmi of the BJP, Dr. Varkha Chulani, clinical psychologist and psychiatrist, Mr. Mohammad Khaliqur Rahman, senior Congress leader, Zavisha Kulkarni, who's an advocate and activist as well, Mr. Dhanraj Vanjari, who's the former assistant commissioner of police, Ms. Indrani Malkani, managing trustee of the V Citizens Action Network, and Mr. Ashish Naredi, who's the executive member of Hyderabad School Parents Association. Let's first go across to Dr. Ejaz Ilmi here with us on the manner in which this unfortunate tragic murder has played out in the past 3 days there, Jaz. Parents have been protesting, violence has broken out as well. Police unfortunately ended up lathi charging some of the parents as well. And on the investigations that have carried on, many of course do largely feel that the Haryana government, the state police is doing their job well in multiple assurances that have been sent out to the parents as well. But there is still a sign here, Jaz, that there perhaps could still be a breach of trust by the system in place. The parents are still pushing for a CBI and other parents of the given school as well still really don't feel that the real culprits are being nabbed here.
Well, Seher, I'm glad you brought up this. It's very clear that the parents are extremely concerned and so is everybody. This is a complete betrayal of faith, a complete breach of trust that every child and their parents have, because the school is an extension, especially in the primary sector sections. I mean, you can't imagine a child going to school and being murdered in just 10, 15 minutes. So all the unanswered questions that the parents have, their queries and the people who are protesting, the Haryana government has said that yes, there will be a CBI inquiry because the parents are asking for it. All the unanswered questions should be answered, because if there's an element of conspiracy as to why a child of 7 years of age can be murdered, and how he can be murdered within 10 minutes of going to school. Was there an element of sexual assault? Why was a driver or a conductor allowed into a space, a safe zone of a school, and including bathrooms which are meant for children? There are a lot of unanswered questions, and if there's a CBI inquiry, I'm sure the parents are asking, they're correct in answering for this, and they should get the CBI inquiry, because there should be no element of doubt, because we can't allow any more Pradyumans to be killed. I mean, there are a lot of lapses that have happened, and criminal negligence is staring us at the face. There should be strict action taken. 304A culpable homicide by criminal negligence should be also slapped on the entire school management committee, including the principal and everybody else, because this is a breach of trust, a breach of faith, and we can't allow this to happen in all our schools of this country.
Mr. Dhanraj Vanjari, if I can bring you in this at this point, who's the former Assistant Commissioner of Police with us. Mr. Vanjari, in your view, has the police acted in well in time? Also, the assurances that have come in from the Haryana government that if the parents want, the CBI can be brought on board, that they still haven't done that. They had to go to the Supreme Court for that. For the manner in which the investigations are playing out, at least, what do you feel?
I don't find much difference between state police and the CBI agency to work in a central agency. And I think the state police, who has very promptly acted and applied proper sections, and they are also investigating the willful negligence. Something you commit makes a crime, but something if you do not, that you omit something, that also becomes a crime if it is contributory to the act of a culprit. So accordingly, when I see all these, the state police is there at place, but ultimately it's a trust of parent in local police, Haryana police, particularly in the incident of this Baba Sacha Dera and all these things happening there. So they might not have that trustworthiness in the state police. So they have approached the CBI. Nothing wrong in doing that. But I think the grassroots level investigation should be given enough time to size up, because the case tomorrow would stand in court of law. And accordingly, CBI can come. CBI can take over investigation at any point of time. What CBI mostly can do is to fix the responsibility of the management. Now, since it is a very high profile case, at the outset, I would like to congratulate your channel, Mirror Now, who is perpetually taking the issue ahead. But let me tell you, in last 5 months, I have a statistics to say here, 1500 children, school going children are missing in the country. Where these are going, in some ashram school, in Adivasi areas, in some poor rural areas, there are enormous such schools where even do not have the facility for urinal and toilet for the children. Forget about the girls or boy or whatever. The basic things are not there. When we call it a right or right to education to everybody, it's a big alarming situation where we are heading to. And to cover all these issues comprehensively, I agree the investigation should go to central agency like CBI.
Okay. Right. But Mr. Vanjari, there's also a sense here that the Haryana police perhaps going slow on the big fish and what they call the real culprits. For instance, looking at the family or the trust here that's running the Ryan International chain of schools, why haven't they been nabbed? The CEO, Ryan Pinto, has sent out a video message, of course, crying foul, saying that they're unnecessarily being accused of a crime, that they're victim of themselves. But is the police here going slow on grilling them or detaining them for further interrogation?
At this point, I will not say that police are going slow, because fix the responsibility, criminal responsibility in such cases, definitely takes some time. That what way the particular people are responsible, whether the management was negligent, whether the issues were brought before the management, whether there is a complaint of, because some parents I have seen talking on the channel that they had brought certain loopholes of the school to the knowledge of management, and management simply told them, give them in writing. So such things takes place. It will take some time recording some statement of witnesses, and I think in all probability they should act against the top most management of the school, because exemplarily speaking, for law and order situation agency and investigative agency, unless they do that, there won't be a proper message. If you some small fry, if you make scapegoat of some clerk or some officer or some professor in charge of that, this will be ridiculous. So
absolutely, not just justice to the end, but more importantly also for the larger picture here, apart from justice to the affected family most certainly, but also a stern message that needs to be sent out. Sir Ashish Naredi, who is the executive member of the Hyderabad School Parents Association. Mr. Naredi, in your view, do you feel bodies such as parent association bodies really have the powers to force a given school management to act if it is observed that they're not following the guidelines, not following the strictures put across by the central and state government for security inside schools?
I'm not sure if you're able to hear me, because I see some audio loss here.
We can. Please go ahead.
Okay. See, the position of the parents in terms of talking anything to the school, I'll give you just one example. Last year here in Hyderabad, there was a school where the parents had a problem with the change in school bus timings. And the parents were, about 20 parents went to the school. They were put in a room and they were locked inside for 2 hours. So this will give you a fair bit of idea in terms of the great rights that parents enjoy with respect to any school. And if you look at it in actual terms, the situation is that the parents with the school, they are concerned only as far as they can shell out the fees to the school. Beyond that, the parents have absolutely no say in any matter related to the school, be it safety, be it security, be it education, be it fees, be it the growth of the child, be it the availability of teachers in the school. You take any subject, parents are just not entertained. For the namesake, schools do have some parent representation, They select some parents who are known to them, their friends, put them in a committee, and that is shown as an example of parents' participation in the schools. Otherwise, parents just have no rights with respect to anything in the school.
That's absolutely unfortunate, the manner in which you're explaining this to us. It's an absolute abuse of power, so to say, that exists on these school managements here, as you're saying, that they're just used for money, and that's where the chapter ends as far as school management administrations there are concerned. Mohammed Khaliqur Rahman, Congress leader, if I can get you in here at this point, there have been guidelines that have been set across by the NCPCR, many that have been followed in various state governments, some ruled by the Congress there as well, but not in all given cases existing on ground. There is a clear abuse of power from these school managements, these business houses, and to no avail to the parents, the affected parents in each given case.
Yeah, I fully agree with you, because very comprehensive and very clear guidance have been laid down, even by the CBSE board, by NCPR, and even by the respective governments of our states, and even by the central government. But unfortunately, because they are being totally ignored by the schools, and they are not being implemented at all, because as Mr. Ashish said, I fully agree with Mr. Ashish, because the schools are actually acting in a very high-handed manner. You know, want to implement what they want to, and they are least bothered, because especially in case of the Rayan International School, it is very unfortunate, and I think the top brass of the management must be punished, must be booked, and because they simply can't get away. And here, if you see, because it is very unfortunate that even the CCTV cameras were not working, and how is that the bus driver or the conductor allowed inside the school premises to use the same toilets which students were using. So this shows, you know, how responsible
an absolute violation not just of the NCPCRC, but also the existing Supreme Court guidelines on child safety in school. Dr. Ejaz Ilmi, at this point, I want to ask you what the HRD ministry has been up to as far as the new policy education that had to be adopted after the findings of the NCPCR pertaining to this very issue of security and safety of children in schools. There was a statement that came in from the HRD minister today. Many would think it was a vague statement saying that we are looking into the issue, looking at some suggestions coming in, but nothing along the lines which could perhaps once again place the trust of the parents in the system.
You know, definitely there is a need to amend the affiliation bylaws in the CBSE, because as somebody just spoke about, the school management committee has two members in CBSE schools, on the central schools. It should be, in fact, dominated by parents themselves. There should be a large number of parents on school management committees, and except for the curriculum, everything from timing, safety, security, transportation, and any interface with staff should be managed by a parent-teacher body, which is largely dominated by parents, because they are the maximum stakeholders in any individual school. I'll just give you an example. We have a situation where most the government sector schools, you pay 1,200 to 1,500 rupees a month of basic fees for the kind of education that you get. But in schools like Ryan International and other top-class schools, you pay close to 7,000, 8,000 rupees a month. There you accept the basic. So obviously, if a wall is broken and the same bathroom is being used by your class 4 staff or bus conductors, then there's something seriously wrong. It just shows that you're apathetic, you don't care for children, and you don't want to spend money on basics like CCTV.
But Ejaz, irrespective of whether we're talking about a public school or a private school, a school that is run by a business house or a school that's run by the government, it's not as if every government school is following these guidelines. The situation in government schools being far more dilapidated.
No, I agree with you. There's also issue of absentee teachers for a large time. So various state governments, being a state subject, are trying to fix it. The HRD ministry has come out strongly in saying that yes, Yes, there has to be a situation where beyond the CBSE guidelines, beyond central guidelines of ICSE schools, there has to be new guidelines issued, because something like this was never imagined. You don't imagine that a criminal breach of trust and criminal negligence can happen where an entire trust factor of a parent-child, the kind of faith they have in a school to provide their child holistic education, can be shattered by individuals like this. But at the same time, not gainsaying, every school, it has to be run by academicians, and the parents have to be equal stakeholders, because you can't allow a situation where something like this can happen in the future. So the corrections have to happen.
Ms. Abhisha Kulkarni, if you could come in on this as well. Apart from parents being the largest stakeholders on this, which they're not made to be, of course, because the school wants to use as much power that they think they can enjoy in this given scenario, should not the government be the largest stakeholder with respect to ensuring that the guidelines they themselves have issued are being followed on ground?
Absolutely. Biggest tragedy is that the state government, the central government, have failed miserably in implementing their own laws. Today, the laws are there, but no management or no state want to follow that. I would like to say that the Ryan International, the most tragic situation we are in now, where every parent of this country is worried about the safety of their children. The same management, I'm living in Bombay, and in Mumbai, we have 6 schools which had come together of this Ryan International School. Mm-hmm. And there are 3 consecutive reports of the education department that this management has been harassing the children. But still, there has been no action. We filed the FIR against the management. The same management, all the Pintos and the principals are out on anticipatory bail. But they have been misusing that anticipatory bail. And I hope that tomorrow in the Bombay High Court, the hearing is going to happen, that they do not get any bail and they get severely punished for such negligence and carelessness on their part.
Ms. Abhisha Kulkarni, I'm glad you've put these facts to the fore. Of course, it's an established fact here that Ryan International School of Chains, unfortunately, being a repeat offender in these cases, this, of course, being the worst case scenario where a 7-year-old was murdered. But in the past as well, in various other branches of Ryan International School, there have been cases of death by negligence. One principal for one particular branch was arrested in one such tragic case as well. But still, no state of vigil as far as where other branches of the school is concerned. Dr. Ilmi, which is why the question comes to mind to many parents here on why the big stakeholders, the big fish, as we've been saying here, are continuously being protected. They think they can get away with it. Even in a while, if you can play out the video recording that's come in of the CEO, Ryan Pinto, actually crying foul and saying that we are being made, the school management is being made a victim of this crime.
I think it's completely obnoxious and misplaced. They are not the victims. They are the ones who victimized and allowed and abetted this murder to happen by not having complete boundary walls, by allowing bus conductors and bus drivers to enter the same space as little children go to use the bathroom. So that is where the willful negligence and the criminal negligence is clearly established. And you can't shy away that they are a victim themselves. They allowed this young boy to become a victim and be allowed him to get murdered because of their own lackadaisical self, because of penny pinching to make their own personal palaces and not using the money that they receive for basic security of the children. That is a willful negligence, and they must be booked for that. And you can, any amount of videos
Malkani,
will not
is there
absolve
a sense,
them of the guilt.
Is there a sense that there is political
come out like
protection
this?
Here as well?
Sorry, I didn't get your question.
Is there a sense that there is political protection here as well, which is why you think the school management, members of those who run, who were owning the Ryan International Trust of Schools, think that time and again they've gotten away scot-free, they can perhaps this time as well?
Well, you know what? Frankly speaking, the children who are the most vulnerable in society, this whole situation is appalling. So when we talk about politicizing this thing, whether the political class is supporting any criminal activity, that is something which I, as an individual, cannot say. However, if we look at the scenario today of this particular case, there is no way that the school trustees or the management, the principal can be let off. Because whether we look at the school premises itself, as many of the speakers before me have already mentioned, that how on earth could a bus attendant be in the toilet which is meant for children? But what absolutely horrifies me is that this attendant, how did that attendant get the job of the contractor as well? Of the contractors, the bus itself. Because whether it was in the bathroom that the poor child has been murdered, that same child or any other child would have been on the bus where this man was on duty. So therefore, if we look at it, all responsibility lies with the school. There is no way the school can get away with it, and any political dispensation, what they're sold, cannot not take cognizance of this fact.
Yes, because please stay with us. Dr. Varka, wanting to bring you in this as well, very quickly before we take our viewers calling in at this point as well, and our viewers have been calling in across the country. They're all concerned, worried, anxious parents. Many of us have had sleepless night in the past 3 days in the wake of this horrifying murder. Dr. Chalani, for the manner in which the school management also handles the case, in Haryana, it was a weekend of protests by the affected parents, by co-parents of the Ryan International School. They were venting their anger and helplessness, but the police also ended up lathi charging them, believe it or not.
Yes, it's really tragic what's happened, and I think there's a larger picture unfolding here where education today has become a commercial activity. So there is no due diligence as to who runs schools. The management is only interested possibly in either franchising their schools or getting the best commercial return from their investment. So the kind of due diligence that is required in terms of hiring staff, the infrastructure, who are the people who are going to be taking care of the children, whether it's bus contractors, whether it's security contractors, whether it is anyone at large who will be directly dealing with the children, is just completely put to rest. The unfortunate part is that since these kind of things are so commonplace in our country and the human being's life is not really valued, I don't think there is any sensitivity even among the police to be sensitized to something as tragic as this. I can imagine the emotional condition of the parents and other parents like us who are anxious now because all our children go to different schools, and all that we hope for is that the country and the education minister at large and the HR ministry at large sits down and actually decides that, you know, we are not running factories here. We need a certain kind of guidelines. We need certain rules. We need certain strictures to come into play before we decide to open
and there
schools.
Should be. There so should be far more really assurances horrifying. Coming it's in sad. From the and given just, state government of Haryana as well as the central government. As we said, that was a very cold, lackadaisical response, unfortunately, that came in from the HRD minister, and much belated as well. 3 days today, this afternoon, after the tragedy. Let's get in our callers. Our viewers have been calling in. Affected parents have been calling in as well. Mr. Thomas from Bengaluru, please go ahead.
Good evening.
Yes, good evening.
Hello?
Please. Yes, please go ahead, Mr. Thomas.
Yeah, I'm Thomas calling from Bangalore. First of all, I'd like to congratulate your channel for pursuing this atrocious activities which have been done on these innocent children. Earlier, schools were a center of education, but now it is they have become prisons. And one instance I want to tell right now is that when my daughter was studying in the sixth standard, in one reputed Christian institution in Bangalore, which is called as Clarence High School, she was a lefty. And one of the teachers called her and told that if you don't change from left to right, then I'll see that you fail in this particular subject. The subject was scripture. And scripture being a compulsory subject, which you have to pass in any Christian institution, so even if you score 100 marks in all the subjects and if you fail in scripture, then you fail in the class. And she also went to the extent of telling that left hand is a sign of evil. You know, and she was totally upset. She came home crying, saying, "This is what the teacher told me."
Right.
And then this is another way of harassing the child, no?
That's right. It's harassment. It's mental trauma. One that I'm going to be asking Dr. Cholani on that in just a bit. Our next caller, appreciate you calling us, Mr. Thomas. Our next caller, Ms. Azra from Mangaluru. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. You know, the tragedy today is that there is a little boy, a seven-year-old, who went happily skipping to school in the morning when his father dropped him. And within an hour, he was found dead. Okay, that's the tragedy. And the second tragedy is that we are sitting here and, you know, all of us are debating about this. And the authorities, right from the top, are sitting mm-hmm. and pontificating about what needs to be done and giving weak assurances to the population of this country and to the parents that now we are going to swing into action. They are going to swing into action now after their little child has been murdered.
I'm very glad you said that, Ms. Azra. These are weak assurances. There is still a trust deficit, irrespective of no matter what people think that the Haryana police has stepped in on time. They have unfortunately stepped in at a time after the murder has already taken place. Mr. Vanjali, the other issue here being raised by several parents and the father of the child here, saying that something's being hidden. The police theory, the police investigations also don't make sense because it seems that the murder unfortunately was done just in a matter of 10 minutes.
Yeah, there is a ground, there is a reason for investigating officer to believe that there is some water under the bridge, and for that reason, the management need to be grilled thoroughly and in depth. As I was looking at this picture, if you see the culprit, the way he is walking, he doesn't mm-hmm. have any regression without any feeling. If you see his face, he yes. just appears to be a psychopath. My basic question here, to grill the management to fix up the responsibility, how come he was employed without making any psychological profiling of that person? What kind of man, what kind of psychopath we are employing on our campus where the children's life is at stake? Number two, after his employment, we have to also find out in a school what type of treatment these class 4 servants are getting from the management. Sometime it may happen the upper level management treat them like animals, treat them like rogues, and then their rogues psychology comes in outbursts like it has come in this Iran Gary, international
school. What the parents here have been saying right from the start, which is why the father, Pradyuman's father, has been pushing for a CBI inquiry, has been pushing for the CBI to step in here on this, is saying that time and again it's being felt that the big fish here, the top management, is being protected. Many are also being questioned whether this particular man who's been arrested is just being made a scapegoat.
I have a point there. If with that contention the man has gone, the father has gone to Supreme Court asking for the CBI's intervention, I think he is doing one of the most prominent thing over here. But look what is happening in this country. Whosoever is big, as much the big fish, they have their bigger and larger political affiliation. Even if it is CBI who walks in, there are incidences at the stage of investigation, not at the stage of investigation, but later on at the stage of some hearing in the court, those people were scot-free. They could not be brought to the noose of law only for the reason that sufficient evidence was not collected. Now, you see in whole this gamut, since some panelists has very rightly mentioned, that is a commercial activity. Education yes. is a business in this country, not a welfare of coming generation, but it's a business. How long you operate it as a business, there mm-hmm. won't be any welfare of children, and such kind of psychopaths will get their job, and such kind of things are happening. As in the opening remarks,
Ms. Abhishek Kulkarni, what Mr. Vanjari here is saying, unfortunately making it sound that there isn't much hope. Even if you have a bigger investigative agency come in on this, at some given point, you would have those accused here in this wanting to influence the case, influence the investigations. It's at the end of the day, the affected grieving parents who have to run from pillar to post.
Yes, they are definitely in a very miserable condition. Because
right, Ms. Kulkarni, that question for you, please.
Yes, I would like to give one example that 2014, there was a gang rape on a five-year-old girl in the Bangalore school. There was so much of outrage. The management, the trustee, is still out. He gets a bail in few hours.
That is what I'm talking.
And today, he's still out and he's getting awards after awards for being the best educationist. Who is going to justify that? How the government is not taking action? We as ordinary parents are going to the police. Police does not take action. Because the managements are so powerful, they are making 2 lakhs annual fees, 2 to 15 lakhs. Taking our own money, they are using it to fight against us at the police stations, at the courts. And unfortunately, the huge legal luminaries also are standing by the management side, and we poor parents have to suffer to get justice.
I remember which particular case you're referring to. This, of course, being in Bengaluru, where 2 gym instructors were caught as rapists and culprits here in this. This, once again, was an expensive, influential school. There was a lot of outrage, a lot of protests, but it settled, as you say, that the accused are still out.
And just 1 month back, I went to Bengaluru to find out what is happening. They're saying nothing. The case is just not moving forward. So where is a fast track court? Who is taking care of such cases?
Dr. Ilmi, if you could come in at this point, we've been talking about how the government can step in to help us as saviors to us anxious parents here. What we heard from the HRD minister today was disappointing, to say the least.
All the boards, they have their rules and regulations.
Has said so.
Mr. Ilmi, go ahead.
The CBSE board has come forward and formed made a statement and have formed a committee. The Haryana government is obviously the education minister. They're giving statements yesterday and today and saying that the parents are, if they are aggrieved, that there should be a CBI inquiry. Then the Haryana government would like to have a CBI inquiry. I'm sure those orders will follow. What I'm trying to say is something else out here, is that there are maybe 100 large schools in the NCR region. Why only this school? Why was the school wall broke? It is individual people who see this as profit centers rather than centers of knowledge. And that is where the problem lies. So that we need to fix that by larger participation of parents in the school management
Dr.
system.
Dr. Ayumi, I'm afraid I'll have to disagree here. There has to be a larger participation of the government.
There has to be a participation of the government to rein in these bodies who are treating schools
as a ruthless business.
No,
please,
Sahir,
do not put it on the parents, Dr. Ilmi.
Sahir, I'm sorry, I'm cutting in, but I'd like to ask Mr. Ilmi that please tell me.
No, I'm not putting on the parents.
No,
I'm not putting in the parents.
From
there,
anything
are guidelines.
Mr.
Mr.
Ilmi, please.
Ms. Malkani,
but
yes, come in, please. Ms. Malkani.
May I please complete my sentence? The point I'm raising here is that why has the registration of this school not been cancelled? Because this is, having been a repeat offender, one.
Yes.
Secondly, I'm constantly hearing about CBSE. CBSE is not the only board. Across India, there are different boards and the center controls it. But however, when incidents have happened, yes, it is true that investigations will have to be carried out and everything else. But why has the registration of the school not been cancelled? There has to be, because other children, the school is functioning. The other children are going. So there is a larger responsibility towards the rest of the children. So therefore, it is not as simple as it is being
right,
made out of.
Right, the investigations on Ryan School still on as far as the Gurugram there would take a while if registration needs to be cancelled altogether. But the question here should be asked, did the school management bribe the government and the respective government authorities to keep renewing their certificate and registration, knowing fully that they've not been following the rules on ground? The security safety guidelines not being following. There have been glaring lapses here, have been reporting, as what the Haryana police has said in its investigations here as well. There was a broken wall, CCTV cameras not functioning, not a separate washroom for the staff, using the same staff that was meant for the children as well, and multiple other lapses that have now been established in police investigations already. Mr. Ashish Naredi, you wanted to come in at this point. When there is a suggestion that parents need to be more active and participating here. How empowered are parents really today in this nexus, in this existing system of powerful business houses running schools and, if I could use that word, really being in cahoots with respective governments or political parties that could help them to survive?
See, as I already told you, the parents really have no say, no power. And if, I don't know whoever it was who said that the parents need to be more active, if you open any news portal, newspaper, every day across India, every city, you would find that parents have formed associations and have been continuously striving and fighting against the commercialization of education. We as working professionals or businessmen, it's easy for us to take leave from office or from our business and get into this activity. But still, parents are doing it, and that shows the level of involvement and activism that has got into the parents. However, one point where I actually wanted to comment prior to this was in terms of the commercialization of education and the role that the government has been playing or not have been playing in this activity, what it can play. If you take a small example, you said that the CEO of the Ryan International School made a statement.
Yes.
Now, if the government were to be proactive, if the law enforcing agents were to be proactive, the moment they hear the sentence that the CEO has made a statement, their ears should have stood up and they should have questioned CEO of what? Because the license for operating a school is not given to a company. As per the laws of the land, guidelines of the Supreme Court and education acts which have been passed in every state, only a not-for-profit society gets a license to operate a school. So
very
where
well
has
pointed
the
out
CEO
here
come in this society?
Absolutely. Ms. Kulkarni, you wanted to come in at this point. The government, has the government really been helping not the parents but instead encouraging such establishment to become business houses?
Yes.
Running schools as businesses?
I would like to say that, give the example, somebody said that the parents need to be more active. I was a parent in 2008, my case started. I took against the Vibgyor High School where the gang rape case happened in Bangalore. The same school, same management. I fought it tooth and nail. And what was the outcome of it? In 2010, when I won the case in the Bombay High Court, my daughter was expelled mercilessly without even giving the principles of natural justice. This is the way the parents have been treated, the children have been treated. So which parent would like to come forward? It is 9 years I have been struggling to get justice. And just recently the Supreme Court has passed on the judgment, and again it has been sent to the state government. State government, I would give you the evidences that the IAS officers have the investment in the same private schools. And this particular school has got a land from the government at 1 rupee, and
all
then
right,
they file the false affidavits, and then they go to the charity commissioner, MADA, and they giving false affidavits. They say that a private limited company should be brought in because my land is lying vacant when the school was already running for 2 years. And then they get the same property alienated to their private limited company. Then they show that trust is running in loss because tens crores and crores of rupees have been siphoned out to their private limited company.
There is a mutually beneficial nexus here running between school management and state governments. Unfortunately, that's what the scenario is. Is this really a losing battle for parents? We've made this as part of our campaign as well. Make our schools safe. This should be of utmost priority to the government. The government needs to stand with us parents, with the people, in sharing our concerns. But we're not hearing the right voices from the given state government or the central government. Mohammed Khaliqur Rahman, you wanted to come in at this point. Please go ahead.
It is very unfortunate that because we had a very delayed response from our HRD minister, and even, you know, the state governments are also not taking these things very seriously. And the schools are being run as the business houses, because when the very motive of the management is to make money and not to impart the education, then you can very well make it out and understand what would be the outcome. And it is very unfortunate that especially the state governments and also the central governments, they are not reacting when they are supposed to react. And I am really sorry to see that the parents were lathi charged when they gathered in front of the Ryan school to protest. And whereas the management, only the two junior level guys have been picked up, and whereas, as Mr. Ashish very correctly pointed out, the
yes.
so-called CEO, you know, has recorded a video message and he has sent it to be telecast. And this is really pathetic and unfortunate. He's the one guy who should be arrested and he should be brought to the books.
And that's what several parents have been questioning as well. Is the state police yeah. going slow?
Absolutely.
They have only just sent out their SIT team to interrogate the concerned person, Ryan Pinto, in Mumbai. Many have been saying, exactly. Dr. Ilmi, that there is still a delay on acting against the top management of the school. Very quickly, please hold that thought. We have a caller with us, Fayaq Nasir from Hyderabad.
Top management is getting absolutely the free hand here.
Getting a free hand is the sense here in this case. Let's get in our caller on this. Fayaq Nasir from Hyderabad. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah, hi, sir. I just had a question. Firstly, I would like to congratulate Mirana for taking up this debate, this issue.
Yes, please go ahead.
My question is, why does the state government recognizes a school without safety norms? Like in every nook of Hyderabad, in every nook of corner, we find a school, high school, international school,
mm-hmm.
and without safety norms. Without any CC cameras, without security guards, without any security.
It's quite like schools mushrooming in every given lane as a business of making a fast buck is what you're saying here, is what you've observed in your own city of Hyderabad. Appreciate you calling you in here. Right. Our next caller, Krishnan from Delhi. Please go ahead.
Yeah, I would like to say two things. One thing is that, okay, whatever you are discussing at the moment, this is only ad hoc basis. We do not have any planning, any system in this country where we can say that things are not going to recur again. Now, my question is that, okay, if a builder is building a school, how does he get a license when he is not an educationist and he does not have anybody on the board also? Second thing is that why don't we have an audit system where each year the school is audited very properly? And then he gives a statement also saying the school is lacking these things. If it is not there, then this license is going to be cancelled.
Absolutely.
Now, this authority also at the same time should be accountable, because if unfortunately something happens later on, then this authority should be held responsible and criminal negligence case should be filed against them. Thank you.
Many thanks. Many thanks for calling. Absolute clarity on what should be done, where the buck stops. Dr. Ilmi, it is at the end of the day, the government that is also helping such school businesses to flourish and helping them survive. It's not about parents' participation. It's about the government net that needs to be in place, which is not.
In this case, very clearly, the Haryana police has gone to Mumbai. They are getting to Mr. Pinto. So is the Mumbai police. We've heard that the whole day. They will be questioned, interrogated, and accountability will be fixed as per due process of the law. Secondly, there's no question of connivance. It's a very serious matter. No government worth its salt can afford something like this, that once you identify a situation where a wall is broken or the drivers are in the same confines with the children and they're absolutely unsafe, there has to be accountability, whether it's the district education officer or the district commissioners who are responsible for continuous appraisal of every school, and the reports have to be sent and complied with the education department. The government intends to go the whole hog and ensure that everybody responsible
okay.
in this chain...
Mr. Khalifur Rahman, is the government, as Dr. Ilmi says, going the whole hog on this case? What is the sense that you get? If you could respond to this apolitically, Khalifur Rahman.
Yeah, I don't think the government is really going the way it should have gone, and government is really going soft. That's what I can feel, because the very delayed response from our HRD minister, says it very clearly. And I feel that because there has to be a very high power committee which should be constituted.
I will not politicize this matter.
And wherein the parents' participation should be there, and also at the state level, at the district level also, wherein the committee should be headed by the district collector or the DM, and then there also should be a huge parents' representation. It is very unfortunate that the parents are not really having any access to the school management except admitting their children and paying the fees. And after that, the schools are not at all allowing the parents to even interact with the school management. It is very
That's
unfortunate.
Right. There is zero transparency.
And government should come in.
There are no district level checks that are followed on a periodic basis. There is zero transparency.
Absolutely.
Information is not shared with parents. Even if you have parents' associations
absolutely.
Approaching the school, as was being described by Mr. Ashish Naredi. Also, talking about the psychological aspect here on this, as Dr. Varkha Chalani was wanting to come in, ma'am, we heard what Mr. Vanjari stated, that the person who's been arrested in this horrifying murder, he's not even been psychologically screened. Leave alone that, the school had not even screened his ID papers. They had sent for their school staff to his home to get in his Aadhaar papers. Psychological screening takes an absolute backseat.
And psychological screening should not only be mandatory for staff who, are placed on contracts like running bus services, security, etc. I do believe that a large part of the educational faculty, teachers, principals, people in positions of power are equally psychologically damaged in some times. Like the Bangalore gentleman who called in and said that his daughter was asked to change from being a lefty to a righty because she thought that the devil had possessed the child and that she would fail the child. Now, if you have these kind of teachers who are taking positions of power and are going to empower the children with knowledge, we have a big social crisis in the educational system. And I have always stated that always the emotional screening needs to start from the top. Your management, your principals, your coordinators, your teachers have to be emotionally fit, psychologically fit, because at the end of the day, whether they like it or not, they are the mentors, they are coaches, they are the people who are going to be role models for our children. And if they have psychological disturbances, which they will simply because they're human, okay, they unfortunately should not be placed to handle children who are impressionable, who are gullible,
right.
who are vulnerable. So I think psychological screening is mandatory for anyone who interacts with children.
Ms. Avisha Kulkarni, if you could come in at this point, since you've been involved on this issue on making school managements accountable as far as safety, welfare, well-being, security of children in school is concerned. Legally speaking, to what extent is this mentioned on paper, on our existing guidelines?
It is very much there. Right to Education Act gives the complete guidelines. And 2012, all schools were given 3 years. 2015, all schools should have been as per the guidelines of under RTE. But none of the schools, the Ryan is the biggest example, no school has followed that. What government is taking about that? Otherwise, also the commercialization of education, there are best of laws available there, but neither the state government is ready to follow that. They are only because the managements, I would like to give you an example that I'm very much worried about any action will be taken in the proper action will be taken in Ryan's this case also, because Grace Pinto is holding a very big position in the National Committee of BJP. What do we expect? So if the managements have such close association with the powerful people,
politics.
Where politics and of course the influence of the money power, muscle power, where do we go?
Right. Ms. Kulkarni, of course, we were trying not to make this political, but you can't do away with facts. One that you've just mentioned,
yes.
There is close association with a political party. You can't look away from that because it's a powerful party which is in power in the center,
absolutely.
Which is in power in the given state of Haryana as well. Dr. Ilmi, can we still trust the systems deliver justice to the affected family here? Let's not be naive about it.
Irrespective of the Pinto family's wealth or the Pinto family's wealth, the Ryan family's wealth or their political affiliations or wherever they are, irrespective of that, proper investigation and due exemplary punishment shall be awarded, because you cannot allow the trust and faith of parents and children who see the school as an extension of their home and a safe, secure environment to be violated in this fashion by gross negligence and criminal negligence in culpable homicide is clearly established under 304A. I'm sure the Haryana government will slap all those charges and investigate accordingly.
Mr. Vanjali, given that there is a close association of the family that runs this trust to the ruling government, both in the state and centre, to what extent do you feel that could be an influence?
It shouldn't, actually.
But it does. The history shows
yes,
that.
Mr. Vanjali, that question for you, please.
Yeah, in this country, what is happening, there is a culture being rooted, not today or yesterday, from ages and from years it is going on. As it has been rightly brought out by panelists, there is an unholy nexus between the education administration and the politics. Whosoever wants to make this business, they are totally, collectively responsible as a factor of conspiracy in criminal act. Now, the schools there, how come their licenses, how come their registration been renewed without getting anything properly being checked? Why not
Certainly. That
education secretary be take to the news of the law and made a conspirator? The way the CEO is speaking on the screen, how ridiculous it is. He said that he is a victim of unfortunate circumstances. Hell to heat, who made those circumstances unfortunate? He himself is responsible. He's just trying to pass on the bucks. And finally, what it happens in this country everywhere. Now this debate is going on, hue and cry, a lot of papers and this thing will be spoken
right.
about. But after about a month or two, you will find everything is just silent. Some people like victims, they are running from pillar to post. Nothing is happening.
We're of course hoping that it's not going to happen this time, because this particular case most certainly should be the last straw. It is an extreme case. It's not a case of death by negligence that has happened in earlier cases inside school premises during school hours. This is clear murder that has taken place at an active time of a school when children were coming in for the morning assembly. That's why the parents are also suspicious on how there were no witnesses either, on
exactly.
how unfortunately the job, the heinous crime was done just in a matter of 10 minutes with no screams heard, with no struggle. That's why the parents are suspicious here, still not trusting what the police has worked on ground with the investigations that are still going on. Ms. Indrani Malkani, in your view, wanting to really understand here, parents cannot be seen as these helpless beings who can be exploited time and again. What powers can parents have on this given day?
You know, that's an excellent question that you have raised at the end of the debate, so to speak. Because as parents, primarily it is our moral duty to ensure the safety of our own children. So when we send our children to schools, we too should do due diligence, and certainly we should not be meek or compliant towards the whims and fancies of schools, whichever the school may be. So therefore, to say parents are not helpless and should not be helpless. So, but what is most important here is that parents must come together. Very often you will find, as Ms. Kulkarni was saying, Avisha was mentioning earlier, that whenever situations arises with one child, the other parents initially come together, then they all say, oh, if we become victims. No, we must, for the sake collectively of all our children,
mm-hmm.
come together and stand by when such things happen. That is why I mentioned about the registration part of the school. When the whole force of the parent body stands up, I am certain that no school can, no management can stand up to that, because ultimately truth will have to win.
Right.
So therefore,
I'm going to be coming to Mr. Naredi on that point in just a bit, on using the power of parents' associations across the country collectively. This is a change
yes.
that each of us parents need to work to bring about. If the systems are not working, if the systems are functioning in a vicious nexus, this is what needs to be done. Taking in more callers.
Ahead.
Rajesh
Sorry.
From Bengaluru.
Sahir,
Mr.
I just
Rajesh
add
from
one
Bengaluru,
point.
Please go ahead. Mr. Rajesh, is my voice going through, please?
Yeah, first of all, my heart goes to the family who has lost that child. But this is not the first case that is happening. Can you hear me?
Yes, please go ahead.
Yeah, so this is not the first time such cases are happening in this country. We have been seeing this happening multiple occasions. So my questions will be to the government of the day. So what is the government taking measure to prevent these kind of things from happening? Because we see the private schools charging so much of money towards the fees, but then they are not able to provide the security, right? So and the government is taking steps towards other measures like NEET, uniform codes. Mm-hmm. But when can the citizens of this country can have uniform towards the fees for all the
Right. That's of course one issue that we have been raising on Mirror Now time and again. And this is once again very closely connected to this issue as well. If you're charging a hefty fees, you should ensure not just quality education, but quality safety, welfare, well-being of the child in school during school hours. Many thanks for calling in. Mr. Rashid Khan from Behruj, please go ahead.
Hello all. And with due respect to all the panelists that we have been hearing in this debate since long, I would like to make a statement here is that we are actually digging a well when the house is on fire. When the call got registered, there were very few panelists talking on the role of government, etc., in the entire education system.
Mm-hmm.
My views and inputs were quite based on the fact that the government, the role of government is weak. We don't know. The common man doesn't know what the role of government is. We have been listening to many panelists talking on the mandates, the laws, the enforcement, etc. But
right.
One simple thing, one fact that we have been missing here is the government is not just responsible for issuing licenses. The government is responsible for making this industry a highly regulated activity.
Mm-hmm.
Government is responsible for enforcing
in regulating it, in ensuring that it remains true to its cause of imparting education, and in not helping it become a nightmarish business corporate structure that many schools have become today. Many thanks, Mr. Rashid Khan. We understand your concerns. Dr. Ilmi, if you heard each one of our callers effectively saying that at the end of the day, the buck stops at the government, the state government, the central government, for guidelines that have been issued by governments decades ago not being followed. They're not being followed on ground.
Well, there are guidelines at the state level and the central level. There are central boards, there are state education boards. And yes, all violations must be addressed to right from the district level upwards to the education minister's level. I totally agree with you. But I must add that the parents and the children are the ones who make the school what it is. And if they decide and they decide to drive and ensure that something like this doesn't happen again, I'm extremely confident that no
okay.
school will be able to stand up entire section of parents and children, because
okay,
nobody
so
wants their child.
You're also asking for absolute parents unity. That's when I said we have to get in Mr. Naredi at this point of the Hyderabad School Parents Association executive member. From your experience, Mr. Naredi, you've said that what you've experienced and witnessed in other parent association bodies as well, that it's a toothless body. It's just about coming together, putting your grievances together, but to no avail. Can we have a setup where you have parents from across the country create that kind of pressure to cause this change?
See, a lot of organization across the country is already happening. It has happened. We also held an All India level parent associations meeting wherein parents from 18 different states participated. However, we've got to keep two things in mind here. One is that all the parents, they are working professionals or businessmen. they're not full-time activists and they're not full-time political workers. So the amount of time that we would be able to take out and devote to this activity would be limited. Given the constraints, we are already doing more than what is perhaps ordinarily possible. The other aspect to this is, what are the rights that the parents currently have? Show me one business, one other business where the consumer has just no say. The education sector, the school education sector today is worth about 1,50,000 crores. And the telecom sector was started to be regulated by the government when it was much lesser. School sector till date is not regulated. And the biggest fear that the parents have is that if they come out and protest against a particular school, they would first be given TC. And if I can tell you some, narrate some horrid incidents which have happened in Hyderabad. 50 children were given TC in Neeraj International School. There was a school in A.S. Rao Nagar where the school director
there
took
many
the child
parents
up
who faced
on the
this
terrace
earlier this year
said,
because they were protesting against the fee hike, which was entirely unregulated. So many parents have faced this, to have their children either transferred or asked not to come to school the next day because their parents were actively protesting against the school administration.
Yeah, so with a sword hanging on our heads, if still so many parents are coming out in the open and protesting, you can imagine the pain that the parents are going through. Let me give you just one more example. If you take the case of Hyderabad, Hyderabad Schools Parents Association has been on this struggle since 2008. I would not go much before, but if we just look at the last 2 years and the present government dispensation, we've held a Mahadharna wherein about 2,000 parents for the first time, and I believe this is the biggest gathering of parents that ever came together.
Last final word I'd like to give Dr. Chulani at this point. Dr. Chulani, this is a very difficult, stressful, anxious time that parents across the country are facing today. It's been the most wretched weekend for most of us here, several across the country. Pick up this phone and speak to any co-parent and you would know how difficult it has been for all of us. It's a case that has been haunting parents through the day, through the night, in the past 3 days. What is that message you would like to give that could perhaps work as a balm today to the parents?
I think we'll just have to empower our children to get used to the uncertainty that life holds, and possibly just leave it to God to pray that it doesn't happen to any of us and any of our children. And I think vigilance and some amount of alertness, if our children are able to get as their psychological kind of readiness, would go a long way in trying to at least avert what is possibly avertible in their young, tender age. Because this, what happened, was really tragic. And I think it was unfortunately chance that he unfortunately went into the bathroom at a time when possibly there was somebody there, maybe trying to sexually, molest him. And then when he yelled and screamed a bit, the perpetrator got so
flux. And in a clear case of being a security lapse, which is why the school administration, the top management, needs to be taken to task, detained, arrested, and a stern message that needs to be sent out through this one case that should be treated as the last straw. Hope there have been representatives from our central and state governments who've been watching, who understand the pain that parents across the country today are going through. That there is going to be rectification on ground. Existing guidelines, existing laws are going to be followed. And the government is going to be helping parents in building trust once again in these school systems and setups, and not instead help business houses make an absolute ruthless business of running a school. Appreciate all our panelists being with us and all the views that have come in from callers, anxious parents from across the country, for being part of us and our campaign here, which is of much concern to each given parent across the country. Thanks for being with us.